the question asked was, why did I choose oculoplasty as a specialty? There are many reasons why somebody would choose a specialty. It could be a natural decision based on interest and passion. It could be based on what is available, what is easy to get in practice, what brings us name, fame and money. You know, there are many ingredients that go into that decision. But when you are exposed to all the specialties in ophthalmology during your residency, you get to know what you are in for. For example, I was exposed to, as part of Hockey Center, I mean, trained there, to all the specialties equally well. So I exactly knew what it would entail getting into cornea, anterior segment, or retina, or glaucoma, or oculoplasty. If I had any doubt, I would obviously discuss with my seniors and the faculty, and they would give us insights into what it entails, you know, to go in for a particular specialty. So choosing oculoplasty was a premeditated decision, I would say. It was a deliberate decision based on the fact that oculoplasty is very wide in its spectrum, very colorful, very creative, and extremely gratifying in terms of results. You know, what we would like to give to the patient, we can actually give in oculoplasty and change their life perspective. So that kind of a fulfillment it has. And I always wanted to do something which is very intensely surgical as opposed to something intensely medical. So it was a natural choice for me. Well, I was asked to enumerate my mantra for success. I don't consider myself successful. I think success is not a destination. It's a road on which you travel on a daily basis. You know, if you feel fulfilled, happy with what you've done on a particular day, to my mind that is success. But in any case, success has several ingredients. The most important aspect of being successful is to have purpose or focus. Diffuseness is a disease, so you have to focus on something very, very specific and measurable to achieve success. Just purpose is not important. Along with that, you have to have passion. Passion is something that you plan your life around. You know, it's something that you revolve around all through your life. So it is inexhaustible source of inspiration and challenge. Once you have purpose and passion, the next part of it is to plan actually. To achieve what you want to achieve, your objective or goals. So you have to have a kind of a roadmap set for yourself in terms of what objectives you have and what goals you have and how to achieve that. Once you have these three, then the next thing is to practice. Practice till you optimize your skills to achieve near perfect results. Then comes perseverance. Perseverance is the ability to go on despite not achieving early success or delaying success or the roadblocks that you may encounter. Then of course is patience, because if you want to have perseverance, then obviously you need loads of patience and loads of positivity. So these are the seven P's of success, I feel. Now if you have some of these ingredients built into your life, then there is no reason why you should not be successful. Well, what is a pinch in oculoplasty, or what gives kick? Pinch in oculoplasty, I believe, comes from the fact that you are able to give what the patient wants in terms of appearance. Patient having ptosis, having it corrected to symmetry, patient having a disfigured, painful, blind eye who comes for cosmesis, getting what he or she wants, gives a great sense of fulfillment. And if you are practicing oncology, then a stronger kick is trying and achieving life salvage, eye salvage, and vision salvage in difficult ocular cancers and such conditions. So you get a lot of happiness in practicing oculoplasty and oncology. I really feel that. Early challenges would include lack of facilities in the place that you chose to work, lack of support, lack of patient volume. It was not a warm department, warm in the sense that, you know, when you join, say, a cornea department in a very established institute, you have a certain patient volume already. One of the reasons for it is that the administrators and not even ophthalmologists who head those departments understand the needs of oculoplasty well. One example is when I wanted to start orbital excentration, I was asked, why do I need hypotensive anesthesia when ophthalmology does not need it? So that facility was not available, and only for that reason I could not do what I was trained and had skills to do. You know, so these are the initial challenges. Then comes patient volume. When you start a new service or a department, you may not have enough patient volume, right? So you have to bring it. How do you bring it? One is to make sure that you have internal referrals, but that doesn't happen all the time. You don't have enough volume even then. So you have to go around showing off your skills with good documentation and video recording and get referrals. So you go from conference to conference, talking and showing off your skills, trying to get referrals. Even if you're not practicing in a private practice kind of a situation, but even if you're in an institute, just because you have passion to practice that specialty, you have to bring in patients. Otherwise, you'll be unfulfilled. And until you have that kind of a volume, it is essential to fill your OPD list and OT list with enough number of cases to make sure that the institute gets the value for what they have invested on you. Then you might have to do cataract. So in fact, I had to do cataract and glaucoma for several years before I could switch completely over to oculoplasty. In fact, it took about 7, 8 or even 9 years for me to get the equipment that I needed and start full-fledged practice of oculoplasty and ocular oncology. That much time it sometimes takes. So you can imagine the kind of perseverance and patience that you need to have. These are not negative part. In fact, these are very fulfilling. When you go through this path and when you achieve what you wanted to achieve at the end of it, it's very fulfilling. Now, those are the early challenges. But then once you surmount, once you overcome those challenges, then you achieve success very rapidly, because there is a kind of lacuna or I would say vacuum in oculoplasty, which will allow you to achieve success much rapidly than a cataract surgeon or a cornea specialist would achieve. So oculoplasty and oncology and whatever subspecialties that you choose within it, socket, dactylology, aesthetics, you have a lot of vacuum there. So you achieve success fairly rapidly. But with that comes a price that you would pay. Seniors who are insecure and juniors who are impatient can make your life difficult. Those are some of the delayed challenges that you will face. What's my advice to fellows? Well, I think you should follow your passion. If you follow your passion, everything else falls in place. It is just a matter of time. Everything else in terms of success, money, satisfaction, everything else comes over a period of time, but passion is the prime ingredient, without which I don't think there is anything else. So once you have that kind of a passion for a particular subspecialty, the next step is to choose a good fellowship program or a good mentor. I value mentors more than the programs or the institutes that offer these programs themselves. Mentors are most important because they kind of mold you in a way that is ideal, optimal, in a way you want to get transformed. You know, from a general ophthalmologist or a generalist to into a specialist. So mentors are most important. So find a good mentor and a good fellowship program. That is the second step. The third step is to invest everything that you have, your all your mental faculties, all your emotional faculties, all your energy into that fellowship program for the next 1 to 2 years. Investment in fellowship, I think, is the most essential and wisest thing that you can do to have a very fulfilling career.